Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are about to begin our session titled No Honor in Honor Killing, Gender Violence, Law, Religion and Power in Pakistan. The session will be moderated by Umber Khairi. May I request the moderator and the speakers to come up on the stage, please? Our moderator, Umber Khairi, is a broadcaster with the BBC and presenter of the Urdu Service's long-running radio program, Sair Bean. A columnist with the news on Sunday since 1998, Ms. Khairi's column, UK Calling, covers a wide range of topics. Nafisa Shah, our guest speaker, is an academic, writer, artist, and accidental politician. She has a PhD and PhD in social and cultural anthropology from the University of Oxford. May I welcome Nafisa on the stage. Mohammed Hanif is a journalist and author. He was born in Ukhara, Pakistan, and he left the Pakistan Air Force Academy to pursue a career in journalism. Anita Weiss is an American scholar who received her doctorate in sociology from UC Berkeley. She is presently Professor of International Studies at the University of Oregon, USA. Nausheen Ahmad, Karachi-based author and gender activist, is a corporate lawyer by profession. May I ask everybody to welcome the people on stage. Umber can begin the session. Umber, please.
Okay. Well, good evening, everyone, and assalamu alaikum, and thank you for being here. Today, we're discussing OUP's recent publication, this book, Honor Unmasked, by Dr. Nafisa Shah here, who Nadia has just introduced you to and introduced the panel to all of you. So if we can, Nafisa, we'll just talk a bit about the book, and then we'll talk about, you know, on issues around the book as well. So if we start with this, this book is the result of what, more than two decades of work that you've done in the field. And I just have to add in over here that this is work that you started when you were just a young reporter with us at Newsline. And then it developed over the years. And I think it was, she was the first one who actually raised and highlighted this issue of karokari and this practice of honor killings in Upper Sindh. And so it's been a long journey. After the Newsline thing, you were at Oxford for graduate work. Then you were working as a district nazim in Khairpur. And after all of this, it's been, what, 20 plus years. You've been looking at this work and you've been researching this area. Do you see any changes in what's going on? Has there been a decline in these kind of sort of practices, crimes? Has there been an increase? Is there a change of attitude? What changes have you?
Thank you very much, Amber. I want to thank all of you who are here today and listening to us talking about this very important issue. And I want to thank the OUP for publishing this work. As you rightly said, Amber, this is more of a journey than a product. It's not a single book, but it's actually different perspectives that I have gathered. And these have, of course, changed over time. In 1993, I began this research, and it was quite incidental. And at that time, we were young and firebrand journalists. And you know that, like a predatory journalist, always looking for stories, looking for the sensational in the story. And if you look at the story, I don't know if it's available, this publication is probably not available in the market anymore. It was a bit of a sensational, not only because of the story itself, but the theme and also, of course, the way I, as a journalist, I covered it. And the focus of that particular story was this particular form of honor-based violence, which takes place in Upper Sindh. But interestingly, the people of Upper Sindh don't own it. They say it came from Balochistan. That's another very interesting narrative, but they say it's not ours, it came from Balochistan. Anyway, I looked at this practice and how this practice served as a mask within which a lot of local contests were happening. If people were fighting on marriages, people were having feuds on land, and this honor became the moral mask through which a lot of scores were settled. So that was my main focus back then, years ago. And then I moved on, I got opportunities, some anthropologists discovered this work, and I got a chance to go to Oxford, and they all advised me that I should look at it deeply and from an academic perspective. And that is the point when then I took a distance, and then I asked the question about, you know, whether it's really a custom. If so many things are happening within it, can we just simplify it and say, oh, but this is a custom. This is an age-old Balochi custom. This is how it happens. And because there were so many incongruities in the way the custom was defined and the practice itself, I not only looked at other factors, but also I looked at how this whole issue is being dealt with by state and by law. And that is when I began to look at a particular law, which is the Qisas and Diyat law. And then the whole perspective changed. So on the so the journey from journalist to academic, and very interestingly then, as when I went back to do my field work, I found myself not as a field worker, but as an elected Nazim. And that was a strange twist of fate, because Shaheed Bibi wanted to resolve an electoral dispute in my area, and she thought that I would be able to resolve it for some reason. So she sort of pushed me in a situation where I had to contest an election. And initially I thought that that would be the end of my academic career, that would be end of my dreams as a writer, as an intellectual, you know, in search of a story and wanting to communicate the story to the larger world. But I managed to, at least, what was very interesting, it actually gave me a new stage, a vantage position through which I wasn't going and searching for the stories. The stories were coming to me, and I became a problem solver of sorts. And a lot of the cases in this, perhaps the value of this particular study is because a lot of the stories are of a very personal engagement with those stories of myself as not an onlooker, but as an actor. And you can actually question me that, you know, what did you do as a Nazim? What were you doing about this practice? So I myself am deeply involved in the stories that I researched. And interestingly now, very recently as a legislator, we managed to pass a law as well. So from a journalist discovering a story to an academic, to a Nazim involved in a lot of these disputes, trying to resolve them, trying to balance status quo and change both, And right now, to a legislator who's actually also, I'm one of the strongest critiques of the law that has been passed, and we can talk about it later, this is a journey. And I'm not going to go into more detail because there are other speakers, and I want to listen to them myself about what they think of the book or of this issue and how we should look at it. And of course, I'm looking forward to your questions as well. Thank you.
You've spoken about the law and the modification. You've spoken about the law and the modification to the law. So maybe, Nausheen, if we could come to you, and if you could clarify, what is the modification? What is the difference in, you know, what exists now, and how is that going to make a difference to sort of honor crimes?
I think, you know, Ji, I can do that also. मेरे ख्याल में जैसे नफीसा साहिबा ने कहा पहले तो उन्होंने कस्टम की बात की लेकिन कस्टम के साथ साथ बहुत दूसरी चीज़ें भी हैं पॉलिटिक्स है और लॉ है और मैं उनकी किताब पे समटाइम्स इट्स गुड टू स्टार्ट फ्रॉम द एंड रादर देन द बिगिनिंग एंड शी सेज हियर टू से दैट द प्रेजेंट कारोकारी वायलेंट फॉर्म्स आर कल्चरल and to explain them with reference to systems of marriage, identity, or territory, without problematizing these concepts would imply that the custom is genetically constituted, ingrained in the very way the social world is created. This would also deny the reality of the power of the state and its effects, which are present in the daily dispositions and practices of the people, especially in the form of the criminal justice system. And it's important to make this comment because hum log samajhte hain ki law ko tabdeel karne se humne sab kuch tabdeel kar diya. In actual fact, in 2004, there was a law on karokari. So it's not just about the law. It's also about how the law is implemented and how the law interfaces with state structures. I mean, even today, if you have honor killing, and Nafisa has written a lot about that, and you know, maybe in the second round I can talk a little bit about that, how even when you go to the police and you register an FIR, how that is not, it's actually not the end of your challenge, it's actually the beginning. And the state structures come in, whether it's the police, whether it's judges, whether it's the local politician who wants to do the faisla, and she's quoted judges in this book, and police, who consider that the local faisla is better than actually following the law. And then, of course, she's spoken about kisas and diyat, that at the end of the day, it's not a complaint of murder which the state files, it's a personal complaint. It's a complaint against, it's for a person. It's compoundable. Now, what your new law does is it makes it non-compoundable, which means that you cannot settle or compromise it, but only if it is considered to be an honor crime. If it's considered to be murder, then it won't fall within the ambit of that law. And our judges, there are numerous cases that I can cite to you where the case comes to court, it's a case of quote-unquote ghairat. And in one particular case, the sentence of life imprisonment is reduced to 7 years on the basis of ghairat because that's a mitigating factor.
Okay, so the new law, in a way, can do something, but it depends on various factors. So, Nafisa, I mean, all the case studies that you've cited in your book, and idhar main aapko bata dun ki hamari mehman hain, isliye hum angrezi mein ye kar rahe hain. Ji, 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 nahi, nahi.
Ji, ki किताब अंग्रेजी में है
किताब अंग्रेजी में है और ये हम कोशिश करेंगे कि दोनों ही करें
मिक्स करेंगे दोनों आपकी कन्वीनियंस के लिए
तो ये जो आपने सारी केसेस आपने बयान किए हैं ऑल द केसेस यू साइटेड इन योर बुक there's a sense of frustration that they end up with this mediation or this fast law which completely flies in the face of you know the state authority the best efforts of the prosecutors or the district officials what is the abyss in which you know why does this happen why does it consistently
meri puri argument ye hai कि हम अगर समझते हैं कि एक रस्म वो है जो सदियों साल से चली आ रही है और उसी की वजह से ये गैरत के नाम पे कत्ल होते हैं तो ये गलत पर्सपेक्टिव है ये सिंपलिस्टिक पर्सपेक्टिव है असल में मेरी आर्ग्यूमेंट ये है कि रसूम जो है वो आपको एक स्टेट स्ट्रक्चर के अंदर अगर एक प्रैक्टिस चल रही है तो आपको उस स्टेट और उस कानून के ढांचे में देखना होगा कि आया ये उस रस्म को फ़रोख तो नहीं दे रहे ये उस रस्म को एक नई शक्ल तो नहीं दे रहे और मैंने केस स्टडीज़ जो हैं वो कई हैं इसमें एक अगर आप मुझे इजाज़त दें कि एक इसमें एक केस स्टडी है दो बच्चियों की आपदा और तहमीना और शिकारपुर में ये केस हुआ और इस केस की एक बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग जेनेसिस है क्योंकि ये बच्चियां जो हैं घर से निकल गईं उनको उनके वालिदैन और कज़न्स ने वापस लेके आए एट सम पॉइंट इन टाइम उनको मार दिया गया दफना दिया गया फिर ह्यूमन राइट्स एक्टिविस्ट जो हैं जब उनको पता चला उन्होंने प्रोटेस्ट्स किए कुछ जजेस ने नोट किया और कहा कि इन बॉडीज़ की सर्च की जाए जब पुलिस और सिविल सोसाइटी के प्रेशर पुलिस देन फाइनली गॉट टू द बॉडीज आफ्टर अ लॉन्ग लॉन्ग यू नो सर्च द बॉडीज वर डिस्कवर्ड उससे एक नई होप हुई कि इतनी सारी एक्टिविज्म के बाद शायद इन दो बच्चियों को इंसाफ मिलेगा लेकिन क्या हुआ कि मेरा आर्ग्यूमेंट ये है कि उन लड़कियों का सेकंड बेरियल हुआ जो फाइनल बेरियल था और वो ऐसा हुआ कि क्योंकि जिन्होंने एफआईआर की थी वो और जिन्होंने उनको नामज़द किया था उन्होंने आपस में सुलह कर ली और जज ने अंग्रेज़ी किसास इंदियत का यूज़ नहीं किया उसने ही यूज़ द लीगल कॉन्स्ट्रक्ट कॉल्ड द बेनिफिट ऑफ डाउट उस बेनिफिट ऑफ डाउट क्योंकि बयान सब ने चेंज कर लिए उस बेनिफिट के बाद उन बच्चियों का व्हाट आई कॉल इट कि लीगल बेरियल हुआ पहला बेरियल कस्टमरी बेरियल था सेकंड बेरियल वाज लीगल बेरियल दिस इज हाउ द मुल्क द कंट्रीज फॉर्मल लीगल स्ट्रक्चर इनेबल्स और रैशनलाइजेस दीज डेथ्स एंड आई कैन कोट मुझे ये बहुत अभी तक व्हेन आई लुक एट दिस मुझे खुद बहुत अभी तक उस केस का जो है इट evokes a lot of stirs a lot of feeling the judge finally decides that because the principal witnesses all of them they retract their statement and what the judge writes is now imagine the drama ke puri bodies discover hui और एक एक चीज़ उन बच्चियों की पोस्टमार्टम में डिस्कस हुई कि उन्होंने कौन से कपड़े पहने थे क्या जेवर थे वेदर दे वर वर्जन्स और दे वर नॉट वर्जन्स एंड एक्चुअली दे वर सो यू नो वो सारी चीज़ आफ्टर दैट ओपनिंग अप अनरैवलिंग ऑफ द केस इट इज़ द जज हु बेरीज द केस एंड हाउ डज ही डू इट ही राइट्स एंड एंड में जो यू नो आई डोंट नो व्हाई बट दिस पर्टिकुलर सेंटेंस फॉर मी actually signifies what I say the legal burial of the case and that is where the state comes in the picture it is not just you know the actual people who have killed her but the state actually buries her finally and then the judge writes finally the property versus blood stained earth empties and clothes of the deceased be destroyed after the expiry of the appeal period while the gold ornaments namely earrings cash belonging to the deceased girls may be returned to the parents of the girl after proper identification after the expiry of the appeal period he buries it by burying all the objects and evidences that were discovered and unearthed so this is just one case and then I have given another case where there is a razinama And the judge actually mediates and enables that razinama through the qisas and diyat law. So what you have is, you have aapko angrezi kanoon, because hamara sirf islamic kanoon, islam ke dhanche mein kanoon nahi hai, terms islamic hai, lekin law colonial hai, procedure colonial hai, common law hai. To ye dono mixture inka banke aapko ek legal, just legal rationale karke in cases ki jo hai legal burial hoti hai. Aur jo 1480 ke kareeb cases maine dekhe, usme se sirf 47 cases ki trial court mein conviction hui thi. Aur ye 1400 case mein 1600 log mare the. To agar ye 1600 log mare hain, unme se 47 ki convictions hui hain trial court mein, uske baad to meri argument ye hai ki sirf qabaili chief iska zimmedar nahi hai, iske zimmedar hum, we constitute the state. Our friends are in the bureaucracy, in the judiciary. We, as a society, have constituted a system or a legal system that actually gives a space for such cases to go through. And therefore, it is a reinvention or reshaping of a custom in modern times. That's basically the crux of the argument.
But the... So the question is, if it's constructed, how do we deconstruct it? And what are the reasons that judges would be making? Is it like social prejudice? Is it like preconceptions? How do we deconstruct it, and what's the way forward? Anita, would you like to come in on what are the factors?
Actually, I was responding to the question you had asked me in an email, mm-hmm. to talk about the anthropological contributions,
sure.
of the work.
Of the book,
so if I
yeah.
can turn to that sure. at this time. Because I, you know, the professor in me will say, I first want to talk about what's really important about this book as a scholarly work. First of all, I want to say that Nafisa has written an outstanding book. Substantive, pragmatic, while both scholarly and engaging. She delves into the historical dynamics of the social origins of groups in Upper Sindh, of how they adopted practices from one another, including how honor came to hold central importance in society. Frankly, while I was reading the book, I really couldn't put it down. Her analysis of Sindh society and its connections with violence are compelling, and I know of no other competing work that has such robust, deep descriptions and analyses of Sindh society overall. Take, for example, what she writes as she describes what is a kacho. Am I saying it right?
Kacho.
A makeshift swampy area that is sometimes above, sometimes below ground, depending on if the river is flooding or not. What in the popular imagination is a vague place, lying outside the domain of the state, law, or order. She writes, the liminal space from where people engage in conflict. Is this clear? The microphone? These areas also happen to have the most karokari cases. And engaging in this further, she writes, and I'd like to read a paragraph from the book. She writes, frontier zones are always places at the edge where the difference between law and lawlessness, state and non-state, and justice and violence becomes blurred and interchangeable. The ethnographic space of Upper Sindh perpetually contests what it means to be inside and outside the law, victim and perpetrator, and deviant and normal because of the opposing moral ideologies that operate in the region, making honor violence for sexual transgression both right and wrong at the same time. Right in the normative world, where honor must be defended, but wrong in the legal world, where murder is an offense. As a frontier, Upper Sindh allows unlimited possibilities for people to enact forms of violence by allowing the creation of shifts in moral meanings and masking the bare violence in the name of moral honor. So She locates Upper Sindh as a historical and post-colonial frontier within the context of power, law, and the ideology of honor. She posits in the book that as a violent cultural form of normative sanction contained within the moral idiom of Gherat, Karokari persists within and even through state laws, occupying a central, social, moral, judicial, and ideological position that mediates social relations in Upper Sindh. In other words, to understand the context in which Karokari occurs, or any form of traditional injustice, we must also explore the relationships between the state institutions and various forms of power. She asks, is Karokari a timeless, unchanging social norm, a rasam, or a contemporary cultural product that people expand, adapt, and appropriate in their everyday politics of social relations and the competition over resources and power? Of course, it is the latter. Society is constantly changing, and what is it that women do now that draws a gun sight onto them? What they do is that they try to break out of suppression and be an adult person. And many people believe that this scares a lot of men. There is no innate sense of equality. This is the idea that many men have, that they have, that they have the absolute right to determine where a woman goes, what she does, even whether she can have a mobile phone or not, despite that leaving a house, going to an office, and using a mobile phone is a global norm today. It's reacting against the latter, that their society is changing in ways that they never signed on to, that prompts many men to engage in many traditional forms of injustice against women. Nafisa, in the book, argues that the act of Karokari is a contemporary cultural product that often articulates social hierarchies and contests over marriages and resources. She also explores women's counter discourses as well, their strategies of resistance and adjustment being central to gender politics in the area. So this study, while relying mostly on the case studies of how violence is incorporated and normalized in acts of Karokari and Sindh, has important parallels for all so-called traditional forms of injustice towards women, said to be not done in the name of justice. The National Commission on the Status of Women has identified a number of other customary practices, in addition to Karokari, that are harmful towards women, including stoning, lashing, vani swara, watasata, marriage to the Quran, forced and early marriages, amongst others. Pakistan's Prevention of Anti-Women Practices Act of 2011 lists all of these as specific punishable offenses. But let's not let our cynicism run wild here. While all of these acts will not soon be stopped, at least now they are illegal. Importantly, too, people are raising the issue of impunity. And now families cannot just dismiss charges against another family member, either for Karokari or for any of these acts. And I think this is a major advancement for women's rights in Pakistan. Finally, we should not assume that because great studies like Nafisa's have unmasked the existence of such acts, nor that laws exist making them both illegal, and that families cannot assert impunity, we should not believe that such horrendous acts have stopped. It was only 3 days ago that Hina Shah Nawaz, a young woman of 27, who had earned an MPhil, the only breadwinner of her family, was shot dead in Kohat. She was from Parashinar in Khurram Agency. Her paternal cousin shot her 4 times in the heart, claiming his family's honor was disparaged by her being an NGO worker. What had she done to lead to this? She started to work a few years ago when her father was fighting cancer. After he died, her brother was murdered in a local fight. She took on the responsibility to support his widow and 2 children. Where was that paternal cousin then? Then her sister's husband died. She took on the additional responsibility of supporting her sister and her son. Following her mother's death, she had so much debt, she had to sell some property. So was this event about her working for an NGO or about her selling off land? Regardless, Hina Shah Nawaz has been brutally murdered just 3 days ago, and the murderer declared he did it for his family's honor. People need to speak out at the highest levels and shout that such acts, those documented in Honor Unmasked, the murder of Hina Shah Nawaz, and countless other women in rural and urban areas who've been brutally violated, people have to speak out that such acts dishonor all of Pakistan and that no impunity should ever be offered to such vile acts. Thank you. So,
thank you, Anita. That was very thorough, and also it gave us a flavor of Nafisa's writing. And it's raised the issue of these kinds of crimes in other parts of the country, we keep hearing. We're not sure if it's whether they're reported more or actually there's more of an incidence. Hanif, what do you think? That we often say that if women are educated, empowered, independent, they'll be in a better position. Mm-hmm. But a lot of the cases that we've seen recently have been women who have gotten some kind of financial independence and their families feel threatened by that situation. Do you think this is actually increasing a kind of a basic misogyny and there's a backlash to this kind of progress?
Thanks, Amber. Since Dr. Anita has spoken quite comprehensively about the book, but I would like to say a couple of things about the book before I kind of answer your mm-hmm. question, because I'm very pleased and encouraged that we used to work together as the editorial assistants or junior reporters in Newsline when one day Nafisa brought this story, and it was like not really a story. Even then, we in the editorial process, we sensationalized it, because even at that time, I remember she had given it quite a scholarly title, the sort of some kind of violence in Upper Sindh, like families. And we, when it finally got published, it was just, there was like this glaring kind of, words called Karo Kari. And nobody in the office, I had never heard this term, and nobody had heard this term. And I think the assumption was that the English reading public in Karachi had not heard that word. So there was that element of sensationalism there, ke dekho, wo Upper Sindh mein kuch aise log rehte hain, jo ke is tarah ke kaam karte hain. And there was an element of, as you said, we were probably predatory journalists who were kind of, trying to make careers out of other people's miseries. That's how most journalists start. That's the sad part. But I think what the story did was, for me personally, I'll tell you why this book is important and why you should read it and why we should talk about this topic. For the last few years, I've been doing this thought experiment, and you should too. Wo ye hai ki aap koi na koi akhbar to roz padhte honge. Maybe you kind of, only read English newspapers, but try and read Urdu newspapers wherever you live. If you live in Karachi, you live in Punjab, you live in interior Sindh, you pick up a Sindhi newspaper, go to the metro pages, ya jinko city pages kehte hain, ya jo local pages hote hain. Main aapko shart laga ke dekhta hun ki ek column ki kahin na kahin pe koi story aapko milegi jisme ek aurat jo hai wo mari hui hogi kisi na kisi bizarre tarike se, kabhi kitchen mein, kabhi goli lagne se, kabhi uski kati hui lash milegi. Ye maine karke dekha hai, aap bhi karke dekhiyega. Koi naga nahi hota, as if sort of there is no break. Aur baaz dafa, ek dafa maine socha bhi ki baaz din akhbar nahi bhi chapte, although we have kind of electronic 24-hour media, but they tend to cover only more gruesome, more high-profile cases. If you're well-known kind of, a person and you get killed, maybe TV reporters will get there. But ye jo daily, jo hamari routine hai, aur ye national routine hai, उसमें मैंने बाज़ दफ़ा देखा है जैसे ईद पे बाज़ दफ़ा अखबारों की दो दिन छुट्टी होती है या कभी एक दिन की छुट्टी होती है. After that, you go to the pages and you will find exactly, you go to the same pages and you'll find, instead of one, you'll find two bodies. I mean, that has not changed. And her book's genesis was Upper Sindh and, you know, sort of a so-called tradition. But trying to answer Amber's question, I think what has happened in our own lifetime, and the hopeful thing is that Nafisa started this book, or she said that she will one day write a book about this. And that was more than 20 years ago. And I'm very pleased. हम में से बहुत सारे कहते हैं कि एक दिन हम किताब लिखेंगे. वो नहीं लिखी जाती. लेकिन अगर बंदा लगा रहे तो एक ना एक दिन वो लिखी जाती है. And that's this is that book and very important book.
Well done.
So one must persist whatever one's kind of, you know, other distractions in life. I think if one persists with one's original obsession, one can do great things with it. I think what has happened is, to me, it feels कि जो अपर सिंध का मॉडल था जिसके बारे में नफीसा ने 20 साल से पहले लिखना शुरू किया था, दैट इज़ काइंड ऑफ मूव्ड एवरीवेयर इन द कंट्री. फॉर एग्जांपल, आई कम फ्रॉम सेंट्रल पंजाब विच इज़ सपोज्ड टू बी हाईली एजुकेटेड, विच इज़ सपोज्ड टू बी काइंड ऑफ, कोई ट्राइबल ट्रेडिशंस नहीं है वहाँ पे, कोई सरदार नहीं है, फैसले करने वाले कोई नहीं है. बट आई थिंक वॉट इज़ हैपन्ड इज़ दैट देयर ऑल्सो एवरी डे यू विल फाइंड लाइक यू नो इन सम विलेज समथिंग इज़ हैपन्ड. And there, I think they've created their own mini models. Like, two cousins sit down and decide that this has happened on our side. The other one, the people of the house sit down and decide. Where it's not, I think family also acts as a sort of institution, which, you know, sort of pehle tribal elders or dusre mediators, jinka bahut tafseel se zikr kiya hai, wo karte the. So I think my fear is that. And things have changed. 20 years ago, we didn't have any women working in the banks or in the shops. I mean, things have changed kind of quite drastically. And it's not because, I think legislation has helped, but if you just look at the economy, I mean, no tradition, no religion, no law can give you ki achha 50% log jo hai gharon mein baithe hain, mard log tumko kama ke khilayenge. Halanki ulta jo hai hua hai ki aam taur pe ye hai ki auratein bahar ja ke kaam karti hain aur wo mardon ko kama ke deti hain. I think uska backlash jo hai, as Anita also pointed out, and Nafisa has written about it, I think that is spread over. So you can have these situations in Karachi, you can have these situations in Kusur, you can have these situations in Okada, and the case that you mentioned, that you can have this situation anywhere else. I think one last thing that's I think quite fascinating about this book is, and doesn't get written about, that what kind of men written this. What kind of men run this system? You know, you'll find like fascinating glimpses into men's lives. Mm-hmm. You know, sort of there are two men, Khadim and Rajab, and they kind of keep fighting for years and years, but they don't kill each other. Mm-hmm. They kill, kind of go around killing their mm-hmm. families. And you will, yeah. And you will see this replicated all across kind of Pakistan, in kind of small villages and in urban areas. It's no more just something that happens in rural areas, traditional societies. You will have this thing happening in Karachi. You'll have this happening in Lahore. You'll have this, you know, sort of so-called industrialized cities of Punjab, Faisalabad, Sialkot mein. And I think there is this backlash. There is this fear that women are getting more economic powers. They are, but I also think this process is kind of irreversible, as I already said. That you can have as many laws as you want, and you can invoke what kind of religious injection you want. Lekin aap 50% abadi ko ghar pe bitha ke khila nahi sakte. And I think this book, what it does is that it gives us. I always used to think that Nafisa's going into politics was a loss for journalism, but I think with this book, she's managed to sort of find a completely a new space in her life, where she's kind of combined her journalistic background, kind of sobered down with age. It almost seems like a meditation rather than a journalist kind of trying to shock you. And obviously, she's brought in her administrative and political experience into this. I've always wanted to ask you one thing, Nafisa, if I may now, that you worked as an administrator, and there are lots of stories where you can be immediately very useful. You can intervene and save somebody's life. Mm-hmm. sitting from outside, that would seem that's something that everybody should want to do, because one would think that the administrative machinery should come to a halt if somebody's life is like in imminent danger. Now you've moved on, you are kind of a legislator, you sit in Islamabad, you kind of, you know, fight for these laws. Do you kind of sometimes miss those days? Do you think if there were more people like you in administrative positions, things could be better?
I'm still very active, aur is kisam ke cases abhi bhi aate hain. I still get, sometimes maine ek, humare rural Sindh mein institutions hain, jahan par agar runaway girls danger mein ho, to wo protection. Or the honor value system offers them that protection. Usko kehte hain SAM. Hamare ghar mein abhi bhi kabhi kabhi bachiyan bhatak ke aa jati hain ke walid ke dar se ki mujhe kahin bech na de ya kahin zabardasti shaadi na kara de. To ye hamare ghar, aur ye sirf mera nahi hai, jo hum unfortunately hum bhi wadere ya tribal chiefs ko ek nazar se dekhte hain. But in absence of state institutions for protection of women, their homes do serve as protection of women. And ye aur baat hai ki wo isi system mein phir se agar ek jagah se wo escape karti hain, to agar outside unko jana hota hai to kahin aur trap ho jati hain. Lekin ye abhi bhi hamare ghar mein bachiyan aati hain. Normally practice ye hoti hai ki main to darul aman bhejti hu, because I don't want to keep those girls, it's too much of a risk. And then how do you make them go back to the community, ensuring that they are protected? Aur isme case hai, bahut famous case tha, jab main nazim thi to meri ek apni counselor thi Noor Khatun Shar, usne ek chitthi likhi thi, it was a very interesting strategy which saved her life. She actually, and wo khud usne nahi likhi thi, but some intermediary wrote that story jo kavish mein aayi, it was addressed to me ke agar mujhe aapne fala fala mujhe ho sakta hai maar de, agar aapne intervene nahi kiya to aap zimmedar hongi mere khoon ke. And we actually got her out, and then but the interesting thing is, till today I have not met Noor Khatun. She went, she was rescued, she went into a state shelter, and she got a divorce, because wo apne jo usko ek forced marriage ka case tha, so she got a divorce. But now she's actually, uski strategy jo survival ki hai, and my last chapter is called The Missing Women. Ke Pakistan mein agar kabhi kabhi, even cities mein agar ladki jo usko state law grant karti hai power to have an autonomous choice of marriage, sometimes she has to become invisible because of the fear that if she goes back to the community, either she may be hunted. And sometimes even the parents collude, ke acha tum jao fite, matlab just mar jao hamare liye na, we don't want to see you. And perhaps that's what happened to her. She realized that she, you know, if she went back, there may be new politics of violence or threat or even shame for the family. So we don't know where she is. I haven't met her 15 years, but at least we helped saved her life. तो इस किस्म के केसेस जो है इस वक्त भी, बिकॉज यू नो वी आर एन इन्फ्लुएंशियल फैमिली, वी हैव एंड आर स्टिल इन पॉलिटिक्स एंड वी डू हेल्प, लेकिन ये दिस इज ओनली अ हाफ वे सोल्यूशन. वी हैव टू हैव इफेक्टिव स्टेट इंस्टीट्यूशंस. अगर दारुल अमान का हम हाल देखें तो दारुल अमान इटसेल्फ बिकम्स अ प्रॉब्लमैटिक. उससे बेहतर तो मेरा घर है इस वक्त. इट ऑफर्स बेटर चॉइसिस टू वुमेन, वी कैन डू बेटर निगोसिएशंस फॉर वुमेन. बट इफ यू गो टू दारुल अमान, there are still many many weaknesses. Usko legal assistance milti hai nahi milti, usko cage mein aap usko, they treat her like a prisoner. Women who go to Darul Aman are not prisoners, they are individuals, they have exercised choices, and they should be respected with that choice. So there's a lot of, you know, state level pe hame bahut action karne ki zarurat hai, which means a lot of trainings, including the judges, the police, you know, counselors and so on. But I say ke yes, hamari yakinan roshni ki kiran hai, kyunki wahi assembly jisne qisas and diyat law minutes mein pass kiya tha, us waqt bhi wazir azam nawaz sharif sahab the, aaj unhi ki hukumat hai. Very ironic ke humne after a thorough debate we revoked some elements of that law, which perhaps have made easy acquittals a little difficult. Not impossible, but a little more difficult.
But what about Amber's question? Are there more cases now, or are they being reported?
No, I think Upper Sindh may there's a significant reduction in Upper Sindh.
You see a reduction.
And feuds. Jo mere zamane mein, I have actually documented. Ke acha, and there's another strategy. Ke jab aapka state law and order system breakdown ho. तो लोग क्या करते हैं फिर लोग अपने रसूम इजाद करते हैं हमारे पास जैसे मेड मिंथ काफला है दैट इज अ वेरी स्ट्रांग इंस्टीट्यूशन थ्रू व्हिच यू हैव यू ट्राई टू बिल्ड पीस सो हाउ इन एन इंटेंसली वायलेंट वर्ल्ड पीपल क्रिएट लोकल एंड नॉर्मेटिव इंस्टीट्यूशंस ऑफ पीस बिल्डिंग तो इस वक्त आई थिंक फ्यूड्स में भी सिग्निफिकेंट कमी आई है बट व्हाट वी आर सीइंग राइट नाउ व्हिच इज़ वेरी वरिंग और ये मैंने अपनी स्पीच में कहा था पार्लियामेंट में कि जब आप कहेंगे कि सिर्फ गैरत के नाम पे आप माफ़ी नहीं दे सकते लेकिन बाकी सारे खून में ओपन है कि वालिदैन हो या कोई भी हो माफ़ीनामा हो सकता है तो फिर आपका गैरत का नाम मिट जाएगा लेकिन वही आपकी लाशें नज़र आएंगी और आज 30 जनवरी को आपके 3 या 4 इंसिडेंट्स हुए एक हिना शाहनवाज का हुआ 2 खवातीन एक मुल्तान में एक मंसेरा में उनको आतिश कर दिया गया दे वर बर्नट एंड बड़ी अजीब बात है कि हस्बैंड घर में मौजूद का बाहर इंट्रूडर आके मार जाता है आई मीन यू कैन सी देयर इज अ टोटल कोल्यूजन और लाहौर में कुछ महीने पहले देयर वाज अ बॉडी इन अ सूटकेस सो यू विल सी अ लॉट ऑफ अननोन बॉडीज अनक्लेम्ड रीजंस एक्सीडेंटल डेथ्स But women will continue to be murdered because today in Pakistan, murder is still a private offence. We don't want that. Murder has to be an offence against the society for all kinds of murder. And that's the dilemma. So that's why we've achieved the half the target, but we still have to continue with this dialogue so that we can, you know, address it.
And Amber, I just wanted to pick up on Nafisa's point and say that hardly any countries in the world where murder is a private offense. And even within that, if you look at how qisas and diyat operates, the life of a woman, you have to pay less. You have to, you know, it's because worthless. It's not considered the same worth as the life of a man. And that really sort of explains to you exactly what the state's view is or the criminal justice view is on women. And at the end of the day, you were talking about how do you deconstruct. And Nafisa spoke about the Darul Aman and state structures. And Nafisa, what I found interesting is that towards the end of the book, you talk about the runaway women. And the runaway women, in fact, are the women who have resisted. So they are the resistance. So they are, in a way, even if society or state structures don't support them, they are the ones who go out there and they actually make a choice. So when you're talking about state structures and you're talking about sort of the worth of, for women, you have to understand that prosecution is very hard. And there are many loopholes in evidence, etc. And even the state at the end of the day steps back and is very apologetic. So many years after Ziaul-Haq, and we're forever beating the drum about Ziaul-Haq, there are so many laws that we have not been able to repeal. And even the laws that we've been able to make a small change in, like the Hudood ordinances, we had to do it in an extremely roundabout way. So it's not a liberal state, it's not a supportive state, doesn't matter who's in power, somebody spoke about the mindset of feudalism. So it's a mindset, it doesn't have to be feudal structures, it's a feudal state.
It is. We have very little time left, so audience se kuch agar hum questions shamil kar lein. Any questions for any of the panel? We'll just bring you the mic. And if I could just say, matlab taqreer na kare, sawal poochiye.
If you could just only ask questions, no statements.
My name is Ejaz Ali Khwaja. I'm from Sindh Social Scientist Forum. Actually, Madam Nafisa Shah se bhi yehi sawal tha. It's a very great refer. Lekin Madam Nafisa Shah, since many, many years, maine dekha hai ke she was Nazma and now she is in National Assembly as well. Large National Assembly mein recently passed hua hai. Uske abhi tak koi bhi rules of business wagera nahi bane. It's not at the implementation stage level. Dusri baat ye ke honor killing ke cases aapne khud likha hai ke wo tamam jo cases hain usme zyada tar issue koi aur hota hai, honor ka khali naam diya jata hai. To aisa koi tarika nahi hai ke FIR mein wo honor killing ka nahi aana chahiye. Teesri baat ke in tamam cases ke andar honor is two way. Kabhi kisi mard ko kisi aurat ne mara hai? Thank you very much.
Maybe one or two more questions, that's a good idea.
Any other questions, then she'll take them together.
You mentioned how the state supports the laws in terms of women being half and all of those things in terms of qisas and the earth. So how do you see those laws being repelled or changed? Because essentially that's Sharia law, that's a religious law passed down from centuries. So how do you repel that or abolish that or reduce its influence?
Any other questions? Should we take one more? Then everybody can answer.
I am Abdul Jabbar. My name is Abdul Jabbar Lakhu. I am former Secretary General Sindh. I would like to place on record that who has been, this is to be determined, that who has been at the helm of affairs, whether it is the privileged class or the underprivileged class, who is responsible for enacting all those laws which we are talking about. It is in fact the privileged class who has been at the helm of affairs in respect of enacting all the laws, and that we, the privileged class present here also, including yourself, what material efforts we have made in this regard. Just as you pointed out that even Darul Aman has been problematic, what financial and material support did you earmark while you were at the helm of affairs as Nazim? So we all collectively are responsible. Statehood has to be taught to the masses at large. Because state ka to concept kisi ko mushkil se aam aadmi ko pata hai. Government mein come, government mein go. But state has come to stay. And that hum jo padhe likhe log hain, hum hi zimmedar hain is cheez ke jo hai na, jo underplay jo.
Acha.
Question ye hai ki hum logon ne practically kiya.
Ha, agar sawal zara simple tarike se frame kar le. Ha ji.
Assalamu alaikum ji. My name is Rashida Daud. And I want to congratulate Nafisa. I want to also thank her because like Mohammed Hanif, I also first heard of Karokari through her article in Newsline and then got to know about it. I wanted to ask her that does she have any plans of writing a sequel, because a lot has happened in these 20 years since she first broke the news. Because jo abhi hum sari baate kar rahe, sirf mard to nahi, humne Samia ka bhi case dekha hai jahan वालदा जो है वो लेके आई थी हिटमैन को हिना के ऑफिस में जो समिया का मर्डर हुआ. जो अभी हम लॉ की बात कर रहे हैं, हमारे सामने कंदील का केस है जहां द स्टेट हैज़ टेकन एंड येट वी फाइंड दैट जस्टिस इज़ नॉट बीइंग डन इन कंदील्स केस. एंड नाउ वी हैव हिना शाह नवाज़ केस एंड वील सी वेदर दिस न्यू लॉ रियली किक्स इन और नॉट. सो मे बी आई थिंक अ न्यू बुक इज़ प्रॉबली इन ऑर्डर.
Okay, I think we'll try and discuss some of these points and questions, and then if we have time, we'll come back for more. So, Nafisa, do you want to?
Yeah, I think one question was whether any woman is, you know, I don't know if you, gender context sometimes ek taraf aur family context aa jaati hai, aur collusion bahut hoti hai. लेकिन कभी कभी ऐसे केसेस जैसे मैंने कहा कि गैरत के नाम पे कत्ल जो है उसमें मर्द हजरात भी मारे जाते हैं. वन थर्ड तकरीबन केसेस जो हैं उसमें मर्द हजरात मारे जाते हैं. लेकिन जब मर्द मारे जाते हैं तो उस वक्त जो है अग्रेसिवली केसेस फॉलो होते हैं. वो जो मर्द के जो वारिस हैं वो सुलह नहीं करते, عورت کے جو وارث ہیں کیونکہ مارنے والے وہی ہوتے ہیں وہ آپس میں صلح کر لیتے ہیں دیٹ از دا ڈفرنٹ ڈائنامک آن دس لا کے ساتھ سندیت آئی تھنک نوشین سیڈ اٹ ریئلی نائسلی وین شی سیڈ ہاؤ وی آر ناٹ ایڈریسنگ دا پرابلم ایز اٹ از ہم لوگ اس کو راؤنڈ اباؤٹ ڈیل کر رہے ہیں اور اس وقت بھی اور یہ آپ کا اور جو ہمارے میرے جو وکیل صاحب نے جو بات کی کہ آپ لوگ کر کیا رہے ہیں ہم لوگ بحیثیت قانون ساز اسمبلی میں بیٹھ کر ہم نے کافی قوانین بنائے ہیں جو میرے ہمارے ہاتھ میں تو وہی ہے کہ ہم قانون بنائیں اور ان اس قسم کے جو کیسز ہیں ان کی جیسے آپ نے کہا اپولوجیٹک اس وقت پارلیمنٹ اپولوجیٹک نہیں ہے دس از آلریڈی اے پازیٹیو سائن وی فیس دا پرابلم ایز اٹ از وی ٹاک اباؤٹ اٹ اینڈ وی اوپنلی ٹرائی ٹو ایڈریس اٹ اب ایشو یہ ہے کہ ہمارے پارلیمنٹ میں مختلف ویو پوائنٹس بھی ہیں کچھ مذہبی جماعتیں ہیں ان کے اپنے آئیڈیولوجیکل مجبوریاں ہیں تو وہ بہتر وہ پریفر کرتے ہیں کہ راؤنڈ اباؤٹ مینر میں ایڈریس کریں اس کو لیکن اف یو ڈونٹ کال اے اسپیڈ دا پرابلم ول اسٹل ریمین اینڈ دیئر فور مائی آرگیومنٹ از کہ وی میٹ دا پرابلم ہاف وے اینڈ تھینک یو فار دس ناؤ یو نو دا ریزن وائی آئی پبلش دس بک انیٹا دس بک آئی فنشڈ ان 2011 سنس 2011 اٹ واز sitting in a library and catching dust. I don't know anybody who cited it, any student who cited it. My end objective of this is I want students to read it, students of gender studies, students of human rights, students of sociology, students of anthropology. It is your work. You take it forward and take it to the next step. And I mean, I may go in a different direction for if I have other urges to write, I may go, but this is something that is now your in your custody as students, as writers and activists, and please do the sequels or, you know, take quotes or whatever else you like, but this is a knowledge for everybody to use, including the West. I mean, there's a cross-cultural perspective in the last chapter, and, you know, I'm sure it will, if different anthropology departments across the world use this work with their students, I feel that my objective would have been accomplished. Thank you.
Okay, there's still a lot to discuss, but we are sort of running out of time. So I would just add to what Nafisa said. Do read the book, because it's actually surprisingly very readable. It's very accessible, especially the stories which you know, really bring to life these cases. They're not just dry, you know, a woman was killed. They bring these people's lives forward. They help you to understand. They, you know, it's, you know, a little bit like some of the cases actually I was saying to you, read like a, you know, a crime thriller and a forensic detective story and, you know, a family drama all in one. So, I mean, I thank you very much, Nafisa, and thank you very much, all of you, for being
thank
here.
Thank you, all of you, for supporting it. Thank you very much.
The book is available for sale at the back of the hall. If anybody wants to buy it.
And Nafisa can probably sign it for you, autograph it for you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and see you tomorrow.